Welcome to Asbury. I'm Brother Hammett, and I'm so glad that you're with us today. As you prepare to worship with us on our live stream, I invite you to make space wherever you are for worship, if you're able. You may want to silence your devices and make yourself comfortable, maybe light some candles. Please do take just a moment and let us know that you're here. You can do that in a couple of different ways. The first way is to scan the QR code on your screen. All you have to do is open the camera on your phone or smart device and aim it at the screen, and you'll receive an invitation to open our sign-in webpage. Or you can just make a comment in the chat or like the video. As you watch our live stream, please do know that our COVID protocols remain in place. Anyone that you see unmasked in this service is fully vaccinated, myself included, and there is ample distance between us. If you're looking for a church home, you're always welcome at Asbury. If you'd like to visit about joining the Asbury family, just email me at the address below, and I'd be glad to work out a time when we can visit. I pray that God blesses you through this service today. We'll begin in just a moment.
Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Good morning, good morning. We had a little gap in music there. I felt like maybe I should tell a joke. I hope everyone's doing well today. The Razorback basketball team really boosted my mood yesterday. Thank you to those in the room that were at the game. I think you surely brought home the victory. Let's stand and worship God together this morning, shall we? You've done for me. You've done for me. Let's sing this out. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Yeah. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Have a seat, please. Good morning and welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. What a blessing it is to be in worship with you today. Thank you all for being here, and thank you to our committee of acolytes that worked together to get our candles lit this morning.
Amen.
It was great to see our church family come together like that. I'm Nick Schimmer. I'm one of the pastors here. My colleague is Reverend Hammett Evans, who's hiding back there behind that guitar. He's going to preach our message today as we wrap up our Becoming series. We're going to look today at how to be a community of vision. And then we'll put a bow on this series, and we will move into the season of Lent, which will start, as it always does, this Wednesday. We will have our Ash Wednesday service in the sanctuary at 6:30 p.m. And so we hope and pray that we will see all of you. If you are unable to make it between 5:30 and 6:30, Brother Hammett and I will be outside the sanctuary doors. We will do the ashes for those who need to drive through and do that. And then also, we will be live streaming the service. And so we will have little kits that you can come by and get on Tuesday to have at your home, and it provides instructions on how to get the ashes ready so you can participate at home with us if you need to. We'd love to see all of you here at 6:30, but if you're unable to make it, there's other opportunities for you as well. Today is our first Stone Soup mission of the year. Amen and hallelujah. And I hope and pray to see as many of you there as possible. I have a feeling I'm going to see a lot of youth, which makes me happy. We are the backbone of the mission today. But if you are able to come and be part of that, just show up at Quapaw Quarter UMC at 1:30 and just let God take control and do what God does. It's always a powerful afternoon for us and for our friends who show up in need of a meal and in need of fellowship and hugs and love. So it's a great afternoon. Two other announcements that I want to give your way and give you something to consider and pray about. As I was laying out the mission strategy for the youth for 2022, I came across a mission opportunity I think would be great for some of our adults. There is a place in Little Rock, you probably know of it, called the Arkansas Dream Center. And it's a place where kids can gather after school if needed. And the Arkansas Dream Center offers tutoring and mentoring and fellowship. And so what I'm looking for is a group of Asbury adults, retirees, or maybe folks who work at home and have some flexibility, that will join me once a month on Wednesday afternoons. We'll go there from 2 to 6, and we'll hang out with the kids, and we'll provide a little bit of tutoring if needed, just mentoring and fellowship. So it's a wonderful opportunity. We don't have to stay all the way till 6, but if we do, then we get to eat some great food and hang out with those kids just a little bit longer. So pray about that, and if you're interested, if it's something you'd like to do or know more about, just contact me, email, phone call, it doesn't matter. And then lastly, our Asbury Youth Group is going on 3 trips this summer. They're going to be very, very busy. We have a group going in June to Bayou La Batre, Alabama. We have a group going in early July to Puerto Rico. And then we have, as we always do, OMP in the third week of July, and we're going to Pine Bluff for that. I always get a lot of phone calls saying, how can I help? And one of the best ways to help is if you want to adopt one of the kids and send them, you can do that. But there's a lot of ways we can do that. If you want to know how to help send these kids to all the places they're going, just give me a call, shoot me a text or an email, and I can help you with it. And then lastly, when you get a chance, you can either scan the screen right now if you want. You can scan the back of your bulletin. But please take a moment and log your attendance. As we continue on with our worship, please join me in a word of prayer. Gracious, loving, and almighty God, we above all give you thanks. We give you thanks for the abundant blessings that you continue to pour into our lives. We thank you for the blessings that we see. We thank you for the blessings that we don't see. We thank you for the blessings that we notice, and we thank you for the blessings that we often don't appreciate. God, we thank you for the ability to gather as your children, to come together in this worship, in this space, here in the room, online, to come together and praise glorify your name. This is a freedom, God, that we should never take for granted, and we give you thanks that every day we are able to do that. Every day we are able to thank you for all that you do. We have so much to pray for this morning, God. We pray for conflicts that are going on around the world, specifically the conflict between Ukraine and Russia. We pray first and foremost for your peace, that your peace rains down on all, both in that situation and around the world. We pray for the people of Ukraine as they seek peace and seek to maintain their independence. We pray, God, that you are with them, that you walk with them in a mighty way. We also pray for the people of Russia. We know that there's so many over there who do not want conflict. We pray for them as they seek to be vehicles of peace. We also pray for those who are engaged in conflict as the aggressor. God, we ask that you soften their hearts and that they seek your will and your counsel above all else. We ask, God, that all of our leaders around the world and all of us remember that it is your authority that we sit under. So as we make decisions, as we move in love of friend and neighbor, that we remember it is you who reigns over us all. Now this morning we pray for our country. We pray for our state and we pray for our city. We pray for our church that you strengthen us and embolden us to meet the needs around us. That we can lean into a vision that you have for our church that leads us into. We pray for all of those who are hurting. We pray for all of those who are lost. God, we pray for all of those, God, who have turned away from you. We pray for our Asbury community. We pray specifically for Clifford Smith and for June Glazier. We pray for Barbara Clark and for Fred Williams. We pray for Sean McNerland and Dave Volson. We pray for Patty Shoemaker, Lanny Langley. We pray for Betty Hill. And we pray for all of those, God, whose names sit at the top of our hearts, the front of our minds, and the tip of our tongue. We know, God, that you are at work in every situation in a mighty way. And so we give you thanks that we may experience your love, your peace, and your grace. God, we know we need your grace at all times. We give you thanks above all else for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We thank you for the price he paid on the cross. We thank you for the victory over death and the resurrection to be free of the shackles of sin and death. We thank you for all he taught us in his earthly ministry. All that he has taught us is teaching us. And we thank you, God, for the power of prayer, that we may come together and bring our grievances, our burdens, our sadness to you. We can also bring our hopes, our joys, and our blessings, our thanks to you. And we thank you for being able to know how to pray. Jesus taught us that with the Lord's Prayer. We'll now say that together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, glory forever. Amen.
Please stand and continue to worship with us this morning.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Sing this out.
Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. Chosen.
the sun sets free. Oh, it's free.
Seated. Go ahead. As we wrap up our series, Becoming, we are thinking this morning about vision. And as we look to our future, we can ask a lot of questions. One, where is God calling us today? And he may be calling us into a new space with our spiritual gifts, with the talents he has placed upon. He may be calling us in that way through our time. Where can we give our time? Where does God need us? But he will also do that with the blessings of our finances. So if you are moved to give to the missions of Asbury today, there are a lot of ways you can do that. The technological ways is you can text to give. You can go to our website, asbury-lr.org, and you can do that way. You can mail a check to the office, or we have a basket right there as you head out. So you're welcome to do that. All of those are used to be blessing to those. So as we take up this time of offering, please join us. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the abundant gifts that you pour into our lives. We know that as stewards of those gifts, God, you call us and challenge us to use them, whether it's our talents, our time, or our financial resources, or all of them. We know that you call us to build a kingdom and bring people to know the love of your Son, Jesus Christ. So as we move into this new season of church life here at Asbury, as we see our vision going forward, challenge us to meet that call. We ask this in your Son's holy name.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom and thou my treasure thou art.
would like all of our kids to come up and chat with me a little bit this morning, if you don't mind. Hello, hello. You're going to have a seat right up here. How is everybody? Good? Are you having a good morning? Happy to be at church? How are you? Well, I have a question for you this morning. Are you ready? Have you ever gone on a trip or gone somewhere where it was so amazing that you wanted it to last forever? Never, you were like, I never want to come home. You went on a trip for Father's Day. That's awesome. That's awesome. For Valentine's. You're pretty sure that's awesome. Libby, what about you? You went skiing. You wanted that to last forever. You didn't want to come back. Rosie? That is awesome. You just didn't want it to end. It was so amazing. You never wanted it to end. Well, I want to tell you something. Can I tell you something? I want to tell you something that there was a disciple named Peter, and he had a similar experience, because Jesus took his disciples, Peter, James, and John, that he took them to a mountain to pray, and something happened on that mountain that was so amazing that Peter didn't want to leave. And our scripture reading today, we're going to get to hear what happened, so make sure you listen. It was really cool. You're going to have to wait and hear. But what happened was so amazing that Peter said he wanted to build shelters and he wanted to stay on that mountain. But he couldn't, because Jesus told his disciples to come and follow him. So that's what they had to do. And it's a really good thing that he didn't stay and he did follow Jesus, because he would have missed out on seeing some really amazing things on their trips, on their adventures, and their different journeys. Like, he would not have gotten to see Jesus walk on water or Jesus feed. Jesus walked on water. It's amazing. And he wouldn't have gotten to see Jesus feed a ton of people with just a little bit of food and all the other miracles Jesus did. So in the Bible, because we follow Jesus, it tells us that when we're really excited about something and we love something and we want it to last forever, we can rest easy, because good things are always coming. There's always going to be something else that happens. It's even more amazing. Yes, ma'am. Oh. Okay. Well, are y'all ready to pray with me? Can you tell me after we can we pray together? All right, let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for all of the wonderful experiences we enjoy as we walk each day with Jesus. Help us to follow him wherever he leads us. We love you. Amen.
I didn't know if I was going to shake that. Our scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 through 36. About 8 days after Jesus said these things, he took Peter, John, and James and went up on a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes flashed white like lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, were talking with him. They were clothed with heavenly splendor and spoke about Jesus' departure, which he would achieve in Jerusalem. Peter and those with him were almost overcome by sleep, but they managed to stay awake and saw his glory, as well as the two men with him. As the two men were about to leave Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it's good that we're here. We should construct three shrines, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But he didn't know what he was saying. Peter was still speaking when a cloud overshadowed them. As they entered the cloud, they were overcome with awe. Then a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." Even as the voice spoke, Jesus was found alone. They were speechless and at the time told no one what they had seen. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning. Nice to see y'all today. Let me adjust. I know I saw online that we may be having some sound issues, and so we're working on that for y'all. And I hope that gets better soon. But I'm so glad that you're here today, whether you're joining us here in the hold on just a second. Can we move this just a little bit? I can't see everybody. It's no disrespect to the flag. We'll still leave it in the light a little bit. Yeah. Hi. It's nice to see y'all now. So anyway, welcome. Today is the conclusion of our Becoming series. We've been talking over the last few weeks, really since the 1st of January, about how we can become the people that God calls us to be as individuals. And also, then we made a shift to how we can become the church that God is calling Asbury to be. And we're going to kind of wrap things up today by talking about how becoming the church that God wants us to be requires us to stay focused on Jesus and to follow wherever he leads. Let's begin with a word of prayer. God, who goes before us, we thank you for being with us in this moment, and we thank you for being with us in every moment in the life of our church family. And God, we pray now that you will prepare our hearts by giving us your Holy Spirit so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, you who are our strength and our friend, our rock and our redeemer. And the people of God said, amen. So Tuesday was Tuesday. It was 2/22/2022. Is that right? And that happened to be the 20th anniversary of the day that I proposed to Michelle Pounds and asked her to be my wife. And it's a wonder that we have made it this long, but she has put up with me that long, and I'm so happy about that. We got married just a few months later. Several big anniversaries coming up. About 6 months after the proposal, though, we moved to England for a year. And so the very first Valentine's Day that we celebrated as a married couple was spent in Rome. And I want to tell you, folks, like, if you have not gotten married yet, don't do that. Because it only goes down from there. Don't start your first Valentine's Day by going to Rome. I don't recommend that. But Rome is known as the city of seven hills. And that's because it has seven hills. That's true. And there are two additional hills over across the river Tiber, and we'll talk about those in a second. But because it's on these seven hills, the streets of Rome are all windy and curvy, and you keep going up and down, and they snake around. And I remember the first couple of days, I could not figure out how one thing was related to another. It was just totally confusing. We felt like mice in a maze and couldn't figure out how the city was connected. Well, like I said, there are two other hills across the river. One of them is Vaticanus. That's where the Vatican is, St. Peter's Basilica. We went over there one day, visited the Basilica, and while we were there, somebody on the tour said, you guys really need to walk over to the Janiculum Hill, to Janicolo, because there is a wonderful view from the top of that hill. And so we did. We climbed up to the top of the Janiculum Hill, Janicolo, and you can see the view. There's Michelle looking out over the city. And what was cool about that moment, among so many things, was that we could finally see how all of the parts of the city were connected. From that perspective, we could see the Pantheon, and we could see the Colosseum, and we could see what they call Mussolini's teeth. You'll have to Google that. We could see everything from that vantage point. From the top of a hill, we could see everything clearly. Now, in the story that Nick read just a moment from Luke's gospel, Jesus takes three of his disciples, takes Peter, James, and John, up a hill so that they can see him more clearly. And these three disciples are really important. They have been with Jesus pretty much from the very beginning. Jesus goes out and he's tempted in the wilderness, and not too long after that he goes to the Sea of Galilee and he calls some fishermen. Those three fishermen were Peter, James, and John. And so then Jesus started teaching them. He started showing them who he was. He healed people. He welcomed people. He taught his disciples to love everyone just as he did. And what he was doing is he was preparing the disciples to do what he did, to carry on his mission after he was gone. They were to do what he did, to heal like he healed, and to love the way he loved. So then, in chapter 9, Jesus sends the 12 out on a big mission all by themselves. He empowers them to restore broken people, just as he has been doing, and proclaim the good news of God's kingdom. And so they go out on the mission, they go where Jesus tells them, they do it, they're very successful, but they still had a difficult time grasping the breadth and the height and the width of the power that Jesus had entrusted to them. Jesus takes them to a little lakeside village called Bethsaida. It's on the north shore of Lake Galilee. And you probably remember this story. Jesus shows up. He's teaching his disciples. All of a sudden, a crowd comes up, a really big crowd of about 5,000 men plus some other people. And Jesus spends all day teaching and healing and preaching and exorcising demons and doing all of that. And finally, it gets late, and the disciples come up to him, and they say, "Hey, Jesus, you know, it's getting late. It's time to send these folks home so they get something to eat and go to bed." And Jesus looks at them and says, "Send them home. Why don't you guys feed them? Why don't you guys feed them?" And the disciples say, "Where are we going to get enough money to feed all these people? All we have is a couple of loaves and five loaves and two fish." They still didn't get it, this power that Jesus had and was sharing with them. Jesus smiles and says, "Oh, I think that'll do. Just tell everybody to sit down." And then he takes what they have. Let's say that one more time. He takes what they have. You see, Jesus never sees what his disciples lack. He only sees what they have. Takes what they have, the five loaves and two fish, and he raises them to heaven and blesses them. He breaks them. And he tells the disciples to go share that with everybody. And sure enough, what do you know? Everyone, 5,000 men plus their wives and kids and everybody else, everybody gets full. And at the end, there are 12 baskets full of leftovers. So later on, Jesus takes the disciples to the side, and he says, what are people saying about me? What are people saying about? Who do people say that I am? And the disciples tell him what the rumors are. And then Jesus looks at his own disciples and he says, "Okay, but you, who do you say that I am?" And you may remember that Peter blurts out. He says, "You're the Christ, the Messiah, God's Messiah." But we said this several months ago. Sometimes we get the right answer, but we don't really understand what that means. Don't know how we got there. Peter recognizes that Jesus is the Messiah, but he has no idea, no comprehension of who Jesus is as the Messiah. And so Jesus explains it to him. He says, "As the Messiah, I will suffer. I will be rejected. I will be killed. And 3 days later, I'll rise again." Well, death was the last thing on Peter's mind. Peter wanted the Messiah to be a living, breathing king, somebody who would take command of Judah's armies and kick out the forces of occupation. You see, at the time, Israel was kind of like the Ukraine is right now, and Rome was kind of like Russia, the bully country, and to come in and taken them over. And everybody in Judah wanted a new king to kick the bullies out and to restore the royal kingship to the Israelite throne. From the time he was a very little boy, Peter and the other disciples had learned a motto, and it goes like this: "When the Messiah comes, there will be no misery no misery, no suffering, no death, no rejection, certainly no bloodshed, no misery. No, the Messiah would dress in fine purple royal robes. He would wear a crown of gold and precious jewels. And the Messiah would rule from his throne in Jerusalem in power and glory and majesty. The Messiah would be somebody like Moses, who was so close to God that his face shined like the sun. The Messiah would be somebody like Elijah, who was so close to God, so holy, that God snatched him right up into heaven rather than allowing him to die. But Jesus was clear. Being the Messiah meant suffering, being rejected, being killed, and rising on the third day. You know, if Jesus was teaching them to do what he came to do, 8 days later, Jesus took Peter and James and John up on a high mountain so that they could see him clearly. Peter was so excited. He remembered all the Bible stories that he had learned. Some of us have learned those stories as a child. Moses climbing up Mount Sinai and with his leaders to hear God's voice thundering from a fiery cloud. And then all of a sudden, they are in that very scene. Jesus' face is transformed, and his clothes started shining a dazzling bright white. Blazing light shone all around, and then Moses and Elijah appear also shining brightly. They started talking with Jesus about his impending departure in Jerusalem. I don't know what you would do if you were in that situation. I think I'd be pretty hyped, amen? I think I'd be pretty excited. But Luke says Peter, James, and John almost fell asleep. It wouldn't be the last time that they did that. As Moses and Elijah start their southern goodbye, Peter blurts out, "Hey guys, it's so good we're all here. Let me build some booths for you guys." And if you don't know this, there's a Jewish festival called Sukkot, the festival of booths, where Jewish folks still today will set up a booth, and it reminds them of their time in the wilderness with under Moses' leadership. And so Peter really didn't really know what to say. He just wanted to hang on to this spiritual experience up high on the mountain. And we really can't blame him. I mean, we love our spiritual highs, and we're very prone to try to recreate those over and over and over again. Because like Peter, sometimes we confuse our religious forms with faith. We cling to the past instead of living in the present. All of a sudden, this cloud appears, and this is it. This is the cloud of God's glory that settled on top of Mount Sinai. It's the thunderhead that carried God's voice when God told Moses the commandments. The voice calls out once again, and it's the words from Jesus' baptism, "This is my son, the beloved." And then God adds, "Listen to him." Because guess what? Everybody knew, even God knew, that the disciples were not listening to what Jesus was trying to tell them. They really didn't hear. They didn't want to hear what Jesus said about his own suffering, death, rejection, and resurrection. And then as soon as it began, the vision vanished. Jesus was standing there on top of the mountain, no longer shining, just standing there all alone. The disciples were dumbstruck because they missed the meaning of the vision. Jesus was going to have to show them. This happens in chapter 9 of Luke's gospel. I believe there are 24 chapters in Luke. Chapter after chapter, more teaching, more healing, more welcoming people who were outsiders, more touching people who were untouchable, more loving people who were unlovable, to simply show them who Jesus was and what he came to do. He would get them there, but he was going to have to lead them all the way. Well, the good news is that Jesus still leads us today. Jesus still leads us today, even though sometimes we do lose sight of him. I shared a few weeks ago earlier in this series that the book of Proverbs says, where there is no vision, the people perish. And I told you that the words in Hebrew mean where there is no God-given revelation, when there is no God-given dream, that the people come undone like a woman's hair when it comes unbraided. They come undone, fall apart, run wild, and get out of control. And back then, a few weeks ago, we talked about how that happens in our own lives when we don't take the time to ask God what God's vision for our own life is for. But that also happens in the church. So I want to share with you what a church without vision looks like. And then we'll look at the opposite. Without vision, the church looks behind at what it has done, instead of looking ahead at what God wants it to do. Without vision, the church focuses on preserving what it has attained rather than transforming the community around it. Without vision, the church looks inward on itself. It becomes all about what I need, what we want. It no longer hears or sees the needs of the people in its community. It never sees the needs of outsiders because it's completely consumed with taking care of itself. Without vision, the church is constantly reacting to outside events instead of proactively growing ministry. You know, we all go through this as churches. The roof starts leaking, so you fix it. Or our giving decreases, and so you eliminate ministry. Without vision, the church relies on its own power instead of relying on God's power. Without vision, the church becomes plagued with apathy. You'll hear people say, as long as it doesn't affect me or ask me to change or ask my group to change, I don't care what the church does. Without vision, a church becomes unraveled and falls apart because it stops following where Jesus is leading. Now, that is not what God created the church to be, amen? That's not what God created the church to be. And I said this in the earlier service too. Asbury should know this, amen? You should know this. You've heard this before. I know for a fact that pastors like David Wilson have told you this before. I know that pastors like, who was that guy? I think he's watching online right now, if he can hear me. What's his name? Tom something? Tom Weir. Hey, Tom. Tom Weir has said things like this to you before. David Wilson, the first Sunday that he preached in the brand new sanctuary, the very first Sunday back in 1982, said this very same thing. Carnus Vaughn has shared this with you before. And many, many, many other pastors, all the way back to the very beginning, the birth of Asbury in 1888. Our vision was to provide a church home for people who were moving to West Little Rock and to carry on the ministry of Francis Asbury. So we know that this is not what the church, what God created the church to be. God is leading us into a future where the whole creation becomes transformed, transfigured. And that begins in your heart and in mine, and then it fans out to our family and to our friends and to our neighbors, and then it goes out to our enemies, as we saw last week, ever outward. And our hope is that there is a day when the whole world is saved, that the whole cosmos is restored. So what does a church with vision look like? Well, a church with vision is a church that has tapped into the power of the living God. And that's the kind of church I want to be a part of. Amen? To be a church with vision, we have to do a couple of things here at Asbury. The first thing is that we have to look ahead and we have to look behind. You hear that? Let's say that together. We have to look ahead. I didn't hear you. We have to look ahead, and we have to look behind. And I learned about this on the Autobahn in Germany. Anybody else driven on the Autobahn? Yeah, a few of us have. So welcome. I'm so glad to be a part of your club. So anyway, there's no speed limit on the Autobahn. And we had a car. It would go a max of 140 miles an hour. And so guess how fast I went? 141 miles an hour. And when you're driving 140 miles an hour and you're used to driving 70, you have to look way, way, way far out in the distance, much further in the distance than you ever do when you drive here in the States. But here's the trick. I was driving 140 miles an hour, but some of those other cars were driving about 200 feet. They might have been going the speed of light. And if you weren't looking in your rearview mirror, one of those had come right up on you, and we saw some wrecks too. So you had to look very far off in the distance, and you had to watch your rearview mirror to see what was coming up behind you. Well, something like that is true for the church as well. At key moments in Asbury's history, God has given us a vision of hope for the future. I mean, that's why we're in this room. Amen? That's why each and every one of us is in this room today. There were people who came before us who prayed that you would be here today. There are people who came before us who listened for God's voice. There are people who came before us who discovered how Asbury could serve people like you in the community and welcome you into the fellowship of faith. We did that. We've done that over and over and over again as a church. And it's time to do it again. Now that leads us to the second thing. I promise I'm almost done. To be a church with vision, we have to be aware of our community's needs. Let's say that together. We have to be aware of our community's needs. So when I was at Hendricks, I told you this story several weeks ago, and we applied it kind of in a personal way. The chaplain at Hendricks, John Guthrie, drew a chart for me to help me discern my call, and it looked just like that. He said, Hammett, here, this line going up and down, that represents your gifts for ministry, and the horizontal line represents human need. And your call is where your gifts for ministry meet human need. The same thing is true for a church family. The same thing is true for a church family. Asbury's call is where Asbury's God-given gifts meet human need, not only in our church, but in our community. So when we know our gifts and when we know how to use them to meet our community's needs, God gives us a vision that keeps us from getting untangled and unraveled. That vision gives us focus, and it makes us reach beyond where we are right now and reach for that place where God is leading us next. We're never through. But friends, you know, following Jesus is never easy. Eventually, Peter learned that himself. In the end, Peter did see Christ for who he is. And when he did, Peter shined for Christ, though not in the way that he expected on the mountain that day. He climbed up one of those hills on the western side of the river in Rome, that other one, not the Janiculum, the other one. And they lifted him upside down on a cross. And he shined like his Lord. And so may we. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God said, Amen. I want to recognize some folks real quick and have a prayer for them. We formed a vision team back in the fall, and we did some preliminary work to kind of get us started in 2022. We're resuming that work now that this surge is over. We can get back together in person. I know some of us are here. I'm part of that. Would you stand, Clark and Brian and Nick and Ashley is over there, I think. Josh is over there. Yeah. Josh, would you stand? Anybody that I've missed? Anybody else a part of that group? Carol. I'd like for us to have a little prayer and bless these folks and invoke God's presence in our work over the next few months. I will give you a heads up. Everybody's going to be involved in it. Amen. We're gonna ask a whole lot of questions. We're gonna have a whole lot of discussions and do some activities as well. But these are the folks who are going to lead us through the process. Would you pray with me? God, we do thank you for your Holy Spirit, for the ways that it inspires us and for the ways that it challenges us to keep on reaching forward, to keep on seeking your face, to keep on following wherever you lead. And so we pray now that you will pour out your Holy Spirit on these, your servants, as they seek to discern your will for the future of Asbury United Methodist Church. Give them a double portion of your Holy Spirit, that they might see you clearly and discern where you want to lead us, so that we might glorify you and grow your kingdom in the future. We pray all of this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, and the people of God said, amen.
Well, this Transfiguration Sunday, this next song has some meaning. I'm a part of the study with Hammett and Desmond Tutu's God Has a Dream study. This week we talked about transfiguration and how no situation and no person is untransfigurable by God, no matter how dire the situation is, no matter what you've done as a person, God can transform you. And this song is about just that. So please stand and sing it with us.
In my mother's womb, you formed me with your hands, known and loved by you. Before I took a breath, when I doubted, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. Sing this out. And you make all clouds. Though I've walked through fire, I see clearly now. I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. And you make all things work together. You make all things.
Don't forget, Ash Wednesday is Wednesday, and if you we will have a worship service in the sanctuary at 6:30, and part of that will be we'll have invite people to come down a bit at a time for the imposition of ashes. We're also going to have a way, if you're not comfortable coming forward, we'll have a way for you to do that yourself in your pew if you'd rather not come to the front. Another option for you is that if you just have a minute and you want to come by, Nick and I will be out on the that's north at the north entrance starting at 5:30, and we'll stay as long as we can. If you want to drive through, we'd be glad to impose ashes on you there as well. If you do plan to, you can also worship online, and the service will be live streamed. If you do and you need ashes at home, we will have those available in the church office Tuesday and Wednesday. So just come by anytime between 7 and 3, and we'd be glad to give you some ashes. Would you please receive this blessing? Go forth with Christ above you to be your guide, with Christ below you to hold you up, with Christ beside you to be your friend, and with Christ within you to give you hope, love, joy, and peace. Go forth with Jesus Christ, your Lord. And the people of God said, Amen.
You make all